Did you know that the proof of the Big Bang Theory was discovered by accident? This is a story of a CUNY graduate who became a Nobel laureate and the discovery of cosmic microwave background.
Billions of years ago, all the matter of the universe, a compressed, hot, dense, primordial energy soup, exploded.
Throughout history, there have been hundreds of origin myths for our universe. Flying horses, massive chaotic oceans, gods at war, turtles and elephants carrying the world, etc. By the early 20th century, these myths gave way to a single cosmological assumption. The universe was expanding. What the scientists could not agree upon, however, was why. Two competing theories emerged. The steady-state theory proposed that although the universe was expanding, it was also generating new matter constantly. This was an eternal universe without an end and without a beginning. The second theory asserted that the universe was expanding but was also finite. Such a universe could logically be traced back in time to a single point in space and a moment of creation. A very violent moment, the Big Bang. When Arno Penzias was born, the world was heading for another violent moment. Just a couple of months before the start of World War II, a six-year-old Arno and his younger brother Gunther were evacuated from Germany as part of the Kinder Transport Rescue Operation. Unlike many other Jewish children rescued in this effort, the two brothers were fortunate enough to be reunited with their family. In 1940, the family moved to New York. Arno's mother took a job in a sewing factory and his father as a carpenter, but it was always their dream to send their children to college. College, he wrote later on, meant City College of New York, a municipally supported institution then beginning its second century of moving the children of New York's immigrant poor into the American middle class. It was here at CUNY City College that Arno developed his interest in physics. Originally enrolled as a chemistry student, he soon changed majors and in 1954, earned a degree in physics, ranked near the top of his class. In 1961, Penzias took a job doing research at Bell Labs in Holmdel, New Jersey. The company had just constructed a 20-foot horn reflector antenna with a state-of-the-art receiver to communicate with commercial satellites. 2 years later, however, the antenna became commercially redundant, and Penzias, along with his research partner Robert Wilson, was free to use it for scientific research. The two astronomers began planning a series of listening experiments. Their objective? To detect, measure, and interpret radio waves coming from the universe. It was for this purpose that Penzias built his helium-cooled reference noise source, a device specifically designed to eliminate any possible interference and allow an undisturbed look at the mysteries of the universe. The universe, however, had other plans. The first measurement came as a big disappointment. On their initial reading, Penzias and Wilson noticed an extra 3.5 Kelvin antenna temperature that they could not explain. To their great dismay, all of the following tests gave the same result. The excess noise was persistent and its temperature constant regardless of the direction in which the antenna was pointing. For the next 9 months, they tried to eliminate all possible sources of the annoying interference. The Milky Way, nuclear testing, man-made noise, New York City, even pigeon droppings in the antenna were considered, but eventually dismissed. Soon it became evident that this mysterious sound had a much bigger source. Some 30 miles away in Princeton, New Jersey, Robert Dickey and his team of cosmologists were working on an antenna of their own, one that would search for the proof of the Big Bang Theory. If their predictions were right, over a period of billions of years, the heat generated during the Big Bang would cool down and turn into something called cosmic background radiation. This remnant of the greatest explosion of all time would by now be discernible only in the form of radio microwaves, energy detectable only with the most sophisticated equipment. While talking to a former colleague from MIT, Penzias learned about Dickey's efforts to find this proof of the Big Bang. The description of relic radiation sounded surprisingly similar to the cosmic hiss he and Wilson encountered on their antenna at Bell Laboratories. In an instant, the magnitude and significance of his discovery became clear. Penzias decided to reach out. In 1965, Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson published their discovery in the Astrophysical Journal alongside Robert Dickey's letter on background radiation. The impact on the scientific community was huge. Almost immediately, the steady-state theory was abandoned to give way to a more accurate and complete understanding of the universe. The Big Bang theory had won. Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson received the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1978. The radio antenna that they used for their discovery was designated a national landmark in 1988. But you don't have to go to New Jersey to experience a bit of this monumental discovery. Because about 1% of the white noise you can hear on any old TV or radio receiver comes from that cosmic microwave background that Penzias discovered more than 50 years ago. It is a faint wisp of heat from that massive explosion 13.8 billion years ago, picked up by your TV and converted into noise. It is the sound of creation. If you have the opportunity to save lives and make a lot of money in the process, you'd probably take it, right? No brainer. But what if you could only choose one? How much of the public good is our responsibility? This is a story of a CUNY graduate who became a Nobel laureate and the life-saving medical technique that she gave away for free.
T minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2,
In the 1950s, America was gripped by nuclear fever. Nuclear power had become a source of constant fear for much of the public, as the threat of atomic war loomed large over the world. But a few scientists were spending that same decade working hard to apply nuclear energy to the unlikeliest of fields, medicine. Could nuclear energy really be used to save lives instead of taking them? 20 years earlier, the atomic age had announced itself to the world at a standing room only lecture given in uptown Manhattan by the physicist Enrico Fermi. Fermi described to his audience the discovery of nuclear fission, which had just occurred the month prior. Among his audience members was Rosalyn Yalow, then a junior at Hunter College. As Rosalyn sat in the lecture hall, rapt, she knew that she had found her calling in life. But it was not a calling everyone else could hear. Growing up in the Bronx in the 1920s, she and her older brother Alexander had no books at home. Their parents, both from immigrant families, had never graduated from high school, but they were determined to send their children to college. So each week, before Rosalyn was even in kindergarten, the two were sent to the library to borrow new books and return the ones they had read. The weekly trips paid off, and after graduating from high school, Rosalyn was accepted to Hunter, at that time a tuition-free college for women. There she read the biography of the physicist and first female Nobel laureate, Marie Curie, a book she would later call required reading for any aspiring female scientist. Motivated by the example of Madame Curie, Rosalyn chose to pursue physics. Her parents were concerned. They had hoped that she'd become a school teacher, and worried that a career in physics might not be practical for a young woman in the 1940s. But her professors encouraged her to continue. And in 1941, after graduating from Hunter, she was accepted into a graduate program at the University of Illinois. When Yalow arrived at the Illinois College, she discovered that she was the only woman among its 400 faculty members, and the first since 1917. The reality of her situation became obvious. The draft of young men into the Second World War had created a rare opportunity for a young woman in the sciences, and Yalow was determined to make the most of it. Yalow received her PhD in nuclear physics in 1945. She became involved in medical research and eventually took a job at the Veterans Administration Hospital in the Bronx. It was at the Bronx VA where Yalow began working with Dr. Solomon Burson on the application of radioisotopes in the study of disease and metabolism. Radioisotopes, atoms that are made radioactive by adding or removing neutrons, can be detected with devices like a gamma counter. By attaching a radioisotope to a particular molecule or compound, that compound can then be tracked and studied. This is a process known as labeling. While using radioisotopes to study hormones, Yalow and Burson discovered that patients being treated with animal insulin were producing antibodies against it. It was this interaction of antibodies and radioactive insulin that gave them the idea for the radioimmunoassay technique. Radioimmunoassay, or RIA, is an extremely precise way of measuring substances contained within a larger sample. Here's how it works. A particular antigen, insulin for example, is labeled with a radioisotope and mixed with its corresponding antibodies, causing the two to bind. The mixture is then added to a sample of the normal antigen that needs to be measured. When these normal, non-radioactive antigens come into contact with the antibodies, they displace the labeled antigens and take their spot. The free labeled antigens can then be counted, indicating the number of normal antigens that were in the mystery sample. The invention of the radioimmunoassay was groundbreaking. In addition to measuring insulin in diabetics, RIA has since been used to screen blood for hepatitis, track cancer-causing viruses, and even detect tiny amounts of poison in murder victims. It has been used to diagnose and monitor all sorts of diseases that had previously eluded doctors. The Nobel Committee noted that RIA was so precise, it was like detecting half a lump of sugar in a lake 62 miles long and 30 feet deep. An invention with such wide-reaching applications could have made Rosalyn Yalow and Saul Burson very rich, but the two scientists decided that such an important technique should be available to as many people as possible. They declined to patent RIA and published their findings instead. Yalow was under no illusions about the obstacles she had overcome and the ones other women still faced. At an event shortly before receiving the Nobel Prize, she said, "We must believe in ourselves or no one will believe in us. We must match our aspirations with the guts and determination to succeed. And for those of us who have had the good fortune to move upward, we must feel a personal responsibility to serve as role models and advisors to ease the path for those who come afterwards." Rosalyn Yalow's life was in many ways defined by opportunity, both its presence and its absence. Institutional sexism meant that Yalow had to work harder than any man in her position to achieve what she did. But opportunity did present itself to her at key moments in her life. The local library when she was a child, the publicly funded VA where she made her discovery, and the tuition-free Hunter College where she discovered her passion. These public goods helped Rosalyn Yalow invest in her future, even when others would not. In return, she made her own investment in the public, offering her life-saving technique to the world free of charge. Imagine how many more of those you might have if opportunities were available to everyone equally. Navigating the streets of New York can be quite challenging, even with your GPS on. But what if your GPS fails you in the middle of your ride? How'd that make you feel? Lost? Well, according to John O'Keefe, you shouldn't be alarmed because you already have a backup in your brain. This is the story of a CUNY graduate who became a Nobel laureate and the discovery of place cells.
Are they overlords who determine the destiny of men?
The year is 1963. John O'Keefe, is summoned to the dean's office at the City College of New York. In order to get there, he'll have to face his fears and navigate the streets of Manhattan in his freshly painted yellow taxicab. O'Keefe, a South Bronx native, never planned on becoming a taxi driver. In fact, after his father's dreams of being an aircraft mechanic were dashed by a shipyard accident in World War II, John picked them up for himself, studying aeronautical engineering at NYU and taking a job at the Grumman Aircraft Corporation. But the grueling schedule involving over 100 miles commuting a day in rush hour traffic proved too difficult, and O'Keefe decided to settle for the freedom of a full-time college student. Luckily, this freedom came at no cost. The tuition-free City College of New York offered a wide range of courses and allowed this young man to pursue his interests without compromise. He took classes in filmmaking, advanced English literature, physics, and a wide range of psychology and philosophy courses, paying no attention to faculty or discipline boundaries. It was here that he also got his first taste of experimental brain research. At the time, there were no neuroscience courses offered, but he took courses in physiological psychology and was allowed to join a team working on pigeon exploratory behavior. After reaching the dean's office, O'Keefe was surprised to find out that he had accumulated enough credits to receive not one, but several degrees. O'Keefe opted to major in psychology and minor in philosophy, and graduated that same year. John's interest in neuroscience led him to focus his postdoctoral research on a very specific part of the brain, the hippocampus. Surprisingly similar across mammals, the hippocampus has traditionally been known as a formation in the brain that contained answers to questions of learning and memory. But in the 1940s, this tiny part of the brain was also marked as the possible location of the so-called cognitive map, a stimuli-based concept of spatial awareness developed by psychologist Edward Tolman, and John O'Keefe was excited to dig deep into it. In 1971, O'Keefe developed a series of experiments designed to monitor brain activity in rats. What he was looking for were firing patterns, or bursts of activity, on a single-cell level that he would later be able to correlate to certain aspects of animal behavior. The first part of the experiment turned out to be a complete success. The electrodes connected to rats' brains returned with the lovely chirping sound of cellular activity. Unfortunately, correlating this activity to any of the common patterns in animals' behavior proved to be extremely difficult. In the period of the next few months, O'Keefe started realizing that these bursts of activity did not have anything to do with what the animal was doing, or even why it was doing it, but rather where it was doing it. The cells were reacting to their location in the environment. What O'Keefe discovered was a biological basis of navigation, a place cell. In his book, published in 1978, O'Keefe went on to present his findings and offer a somewhat blunt prediction. Place cells are cells that constitute spatial awareness in humans, but they're not the only ones. The hippocampus and associated brain areas contain networks of cells that create geographical maps and perform navigational computations. Nevertheless, many found it hard to accept that the human hippocampus could have a similar function to that of a rodent. Luckily, there was a new player in town. Duke Newcomb. By the early 90s, advancements in technology allowed alternative ways of experimenting, this time on humans. Emptied of monsters, guns, and an equal number of rats, Duke Newcomb became a complex environment with multiple rooms and pathways. A virtual space volunteers could learn how to navigate while their brains were being scanned for the clues of the cognitive map. The study proved that the human hippocampus and surrounding areas of the brain become active whenever a person is engaged in spatial navigation. In addition, there was a good correlation between the accuracy of navigation and the amount of blood flow in the hippocampus. ¶¶ decade later, an experimental study conducted with taxi drivers showed that the hippocampi of expert and highly practiced human navigators were larger in volume than the ones found in average humans. Little did young O'Keefe know, as he drove a taxi during his days at City College, that he was playing out an experiment which would go on to support his own theories 50 years later. In 2014, John O'Keefe, a former CUNY student with wide-ranging interests and a passion for neuroscience, received a Nobel Prize in Medicine for his discovery of cells that constitute a positioning system in the brain. So the next time your GPS fails you, try to remember that our brains come with a fully functional one at no additional cost.